Emotional eating, food as a universal remedy for better and for worse. Hi guys, my name is Lena Semenek and this is my YouTube channel, Psychology of Happiness. Welcome. If you're new to my channel, please consider subscribing and clicking this notification bell so you won't miss any of my future videos. Here on my YouTube, I teach you about money, relationship, success, health, emotional eating, and everything that will help you to become happier and more successful in life. Today we're gonna talk about emotional eating, food as a universal remedy for better and for worse. This is one of my 5 free self-development webinars about emotional eating. Today is the webinar number 4. If you haven't seen my other 3 self-development webinars, all the links are in the video description. So this webinar is before my 12-week online course, Weight Loss Vaccine. The online course, Weight Loss Vaccine, is already waiting for you to enroll, so please consider checking it out. I have a detailed breakdown of this course on my website. Again, all the links are in the video description. There are a total of 5 free webinars about emotional eating, food addictions, passive and aggressive dependency, about bonding between food, sexuality, and money. So, from my previous webinars, you already know that food can help us to lower our stress level and anxiety. If you feel nervous, you can eat chocolate and feel better. If you had a tough day, a nice dinner with a glass of wine can help you to forget about your bad day and relax. Food helps us with fatigue, anger, loneliness, and almost every possible emotion that exists. Again, if you haven't watched my previous webinars yet, watch them after this one. In order to understand how we are emotionally dependent on food, let's talk about how emotional eating is developed. From the moment we are born, through our childhood, teenage years, and into our adulthood. I will start with newborns. When a baby is born, the only way that he can communicate with his mother is through crying. When a baby is crying, the most common reaction for the mother is to feed the baby. If the baby does not eat, then the mother tries to determine what else could be causing him to cry. The baby is learning, no matter what the situation is, I have to eat first. If I feel discomfort, if I feel pain, if I am afraid, or if I need attention, first I must eat, and then I can have my other needs attended to. So, if a mother is having trouble understanding why the baby is crying and having a hard time fulfilling the baby's needs, then the baby can start to develop a mechanism of substituting his emotions, his needs, his desires with food. When the baby grows up and becomes a toddler, this mechanism can become stronger. Between ages 2 and 3, the baby can start manipulating their parents. This is the way they are learning their boundaries and testing their parents. A 3 or 4-year-old can cry, scream, and throw a tantrum when he wants to get something from his parents. In order to calm down a child, parents, grandparents, nannies will offer food to the child saying, "Oh, please don't cry, honey, please don't cry, sweetheart. How about if we go and get some ice cream?" Or parents can say, "Who wants to have pizza tonight?" Often parents are trying to distract the child with promises that they will give them a candy, an ice cream, or some other type of food. Again, instead of solving the problem, kids are learning how to shift their awareness from the problem towards food. The preschool period. The baby is growing and it's time for daycare, preschool, and kindergarten. In preschool, children learn that there are other kids around them and that they have to compromise. A child might come home from kindergarten crying or sad because another child did not share his toy. The parents might feel bad for their little one, and in order to make him feel good, they can say something like, "Oh, you had a tough day. Let's make it better. Let's go to your favorite frozen yogurt place." The child is learning again that when he has a bad day, he can cheer himself up with food. The next stage is elementary and middle school. The child is growing and attending elementary school and middle school. This is a time for school parties, birthdays, sleepovers, and school competitions. Most of those events include pizza, hot dogs, candy, french fries, cupcakes, and soda. Here, a child develops a new mechanism. All of the happiest events in their life are paired with unhealthy food. They build an association between unhealthy food and happiness, unhealthy food and friendship, unhealthy food and victory, unhealthy food and joy. A birthday party is not a birthday party without pizza, chips, and cake. You cannot celebrate any event without a dessert. When a child wins a school competition and receives an award, the parents feel proud. Parents want to celebrate this achievement. They may take a child to a restaurant or let them invite friends over. The parents say, "You deserve it, son. Today you can do anything you want because you won this award. I'm proud of you. This is your day. Tell me, what do you want to do? Where do you want to go to celebrate? What should we order?" Again, celebration comes with lots of calories. When people get excited, they cannot control how much they eat, especially when other people are still eating. Overall, we always eat more than we need during a party. To summarize, a child is learning that when life is good, when you hang out with friends, when you celebrate an event, you have the full right to eat as much unhealthy food as you want. Let's move on. The next stage is the late teenage years. At this point, we have already developed our food habits. At this stage of development, the parents have less leverage over the happiness of their child. This is the time when a child can be moody and distant. The parents are struggling to connect with the child emotionally. When a teenage son comes home in a bad mood, his mother can't comfort him as she used to. A mother who sees that her child is in a bad mood might go for what has always worked. She might say, "I ordered pizza for dinner. Honey, let's come and eat." So again, a child is learning. He's actually confirming that food can bring happiness. Food can change your mood. And finally, adulthood. At this point, it is almost certain that this behavior will continue into adulthood. When a husband comes home angry and emotional, his wife might say, "Come down and eat first. I made your favorite lamb chops and bought your favorite ice cream." This is the way we were raised, and now we are raising our kids. We are repeating patterns that we learned from our parents. We cannot change our parents. They raised us only the way they knew how. The past is in the past. We cannot judge their decisions and blame them for what they did or did not do. Blaming our parents won't bring us positive results. We might end up in a bigger misunderstanding and conflict with them. What we can do is to change our own lives, our own belief system, and create new behaviors, new reactions that will benefit us going forward. We cannot judge our parents because we also make mistakes raising our own kids. The most important thing here to understand is we have to notice our own detrimental behaviors and limiting beliefs and start working on them. The good news is being aware of what you eat can help you identify which emotions or feelings you're trying to suppress. Please watch my free webinar entitled "Tell Me What You Eat and I Will Tell You What Problems You Have." The link is below the video. Let's continue today's topic and talk about why people want to eat before bedtime and why people wake up hungry in the middle of the night. Before discussing this intriguing topic, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel and click the bell icon so you won't miss any of my future videos. I personally never wake up hungry in the middle of the night, but I do feel hungry before bed, even when I eat enough. If you can relate, then probably you're using food to deal with your emotions as well. More precisely, you're using food to suppress your emotions. For me, it is mostly about anxiety and self-worth. Let's say you wake up in the morning feeling fresh and energized. During the day, you have your regular things to do, which takes a good amount of energy. Maybe today you had a few unexpected items that you had to address. Or maybe you did not sleep well. Maybe it was a hard day for you. But few days ago, you decided that you are not going to eat junk food anymore. You will limit the amount of sweets and start a healthy lifestyle. So you have a healthy breakfast, light lunch and dinner. If you count your calories, you did pretty good. Maybe you went to the gym and even burned some extra calories. Now it's a night time and you feel hungry. You know that you ate enough, but you are drawn to the refrigerator. It's hard to control your hunger and you feel bad about yourself. So let's decode this behavior. In the morning, when you wake up, your container of energy was full. You had 100%. During the day, you experienced some stress. The modern world can be stressful. Just driving on the freeway can cause you a lot of stress. Maybe you had some issues at work. Maybe your kids added some problems to your plate. Maybe your mom called you, which can also be stressful. So by the middle of the day, you have already drained about 60 to 70% of your energy. Previously, you used to fill your internal container of energy with heavy food during lunch. You used to eat a lot of calories and suppress your emotions with food. But today you had a light lunch. Your body did not get its usual boost of calories from fatty, unhealthy food. And you limit yourself from the type of food and the amount of food that you eat. So your emotional hunger is not fulfilled either. There is still half of the day ahead of you. You hope that the rest of the day will go smoothly, but unfortunately, you might face even more problems in the afternoon. Now your container may be also 30-50% full. You're not as fast and productive as you were in the morning. You keep draining the energy from your container. By the time you come home for dinner, you maybe have only 10-15% of your daily energy. You're hungry, maybe angry, maybe stressed out, and definitely tired. You eat your dinner, but again, because you decided to be healthy, you have to manage what you eat and how much you eat. You still get some energy from food, but what about the emotions that you used to suppress with food? You are overloaded with emotions by the end of the day, but you cannot use food anymore to deal with them. So your stress and anxiety level is rising even higher. Your container of energy is here. You don't have enough energy anymore to deal with your emotions. But your emotions are raising up, higher and higher and higher. The more you limit your food intake, the higher your level of anxiety will be at the end of the day. Your wife, your husband, your kids, your dog, all of them want your attention. They also have their problems and needs that they want to share. So before bedtime or during the night, you realize that you're extremely hungry. Your anxiety level is here, but your container is almost empty. Assume that the first few days you were able to get through it somehow. But by the end of the week, you can't do it anymore. Every morning you wake up with less and less and less energy. Because you were not able to suppress your stress and emotions with food, they were building up inside of you. The anxiety level was going higher, higher and higher. The stress level was going higher, higher and higher. So every morning you wake up with a bag of unresolved emotions from the day before. The size of the bag is growing day after day. By the end of the week, you can't do it anymore. You break. You might scream at your kids or fight with your spouse. Now you decide to quit your diet and treat yourself with food because you deserve it. You had a super stressful week and now it's time to allow yourself to relax and eat your favorite pizza, french fries and burger. This is why many people gain even more weight after dieting. This is why dieting and exercise does not work when we have psychological problems related to food. The inability to understand our own emotions that we hold on to every day can overwhelm us. We live in a stressful world. The idea that you should focus on the good things in life and not let your negative emotions to control you is more complicated than it sounds. If you focus only on the good things and do not address your negative emotions, then you have to suppress them. And those emotions are not going anywhere. You are stocking them inside, creating an invisible bomb that will burst one day. The goal is to understand your emotions. If you know what emotions you are trying to suppress, then you can address them and you can release them in a healthy way. The goal is not to be perfect. There is no perfect people. It's not possible to be 100% healed from all your childhood traumas. The goal is to learn how to connect with your inner self, how to identify your own emotions and how to understand your own reactions. And of course, how to deal with them in a healthy way. The goal is not to pretend that everything is fine. The goal is not to ignore your negative emotions and your negative feelings, but rather understand what is happening inside of you and work on it. Learn how to manage your anxiety. Learn how to manage your stress level. Learn how to understand what is happening inside of you. Learn how to increase your self-worth and how to create healthy boundaries within yourself and others. In the online course, Weight Loss Vaccine, I will teach you a guided meditation called Magical Cafe. I will teach you this amazing technique that can help you to heal your emotional hunger and fulfill your desires. As you know, we use food to deal with our emotions. Let's fulfill our needs in a healthy way so we don't have to do it in a real life with overeating. If you are interested in this 12-week healing online course, Weight Loss Vaccine, the link is below the video. This online course is not about dieting, is not about exercising, is not about counting calories. This is about how to heal your psychological problems that make you eat more food than you need. Watch my other free webinars about emotional eating. The second webinar is Emotional Eating. Tell me what you eat and I will tell you what problems you have. The third webinar is Oral Personality Type, about food dependency, aggressive dependency and passive dependency. The fourth webinar is today's webinar, Emotional Eating as a Universal Remedy for Better and for Worse. And the final webinar, number 5, is food, sexuality, and money. If you want to know how overeating is related to sex and money, how to manage your emotions, and how to create loving, happy relationships that last, check out the breakdown of my 12-week online course, Weight Loss Vaccine. And enroll today. Right now, you can sign up for 50% off. This is a limited time offer. So please check the link below this video to see how this course can help you to become healthier and more successful in life. Please give me a thumbs up to support this channel. Share all of your questions in the comments below. If you have a private question, you can send it to me on my website or you can sign up for the private online session with me. I am looking forward to hearing from you. Please help me to promote this channel, Psychology of Happiness. Share this video with your friends and family. Post it on your Facebook, Twitter, on Instagram, and just send it by email to your friends. My name is Elena Semenek, and this is my YouTube channel, Psychology of Happiness. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell so you won't miss any of my future self-development webinars and self-improvement videos. I am looking forward to seeing your likes and your comments. Until the next time, bye.